vast army arrayed against God's people. And King Jehoshaphat asked God what to do. And the answer was to go out and watch what I will do. Knowing the power of praise and worship, who did he put in the front lines? The praisers. He put the praise and worshipers in the front lines. And verse 21 says, this is what they sang. Give thanks to the Lord. His faithful love endures forever. And at the moment they began to sing, verse 22 says, to sing and give praise, the Lord caused the enemy armies to start fighting against each other, and so they annihilated each other. So as we stand and sing today, let us also put on the power of praise and worship and see what God is going to do. I believe this might be another tumultuous week in our nation. So we want to start with the praise and worship here. Would you stand and join us as we sing? And let's start off. Would you just repeat with me first what the armies of Israel sang? Give thanks to the Lord. His faithful love endures forever. I'll say part of it and you just repeat it. Give thanks to the Lord.
Give thanks to the Lord.
His faithful love.
Endures forever.
Let's say it again. Give thanks to the Lord.
His faithful love endures forever.
That's powerful. Let's sing. Come. Now is the time to worship.
Good morning. Now, as I always like to typically do, I offer up a praise when I come up and hear if there might be any others out there. I just think it's wonderful how pretty it looks outside. Can we agree on that? I mean, me, not the biggest winter kind of guy, but I can honestly say that when it looks like this and the snow's out there and everything is just so white and pure and clean looking, just makes me feel good. Anybody else have any praises before we go to prayer? Okay, now I didn't get any. Oh, hold on a second. Roseanne. Say his name was Brent Walker?
Brian Sawafford.
Wow, I wasn't even close. Brian Sawafford.
He is, like the next day, he got taken off the respirator and off oxygen altogether. He was put in a regular room, I believe, down in ICU, and he may come home tomorrow.
Wow. That's miraculous. Yes, that's miraculous. That's a great tie-in. We've got prayer and praise meeting there. That is wonderful stuff. Now, what I thought was, I still, even though we didn't get any prayers, I got to believe there's some out there. There's some unspoken ones. And so what I'm going to do is about halfway through, I'm going to pause for a moment. And at that time, I'd like you to maybe do that praying to yourself on those unspoken prayers, and then I'll finish up and pray for Lee as he comes up. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray for peace and unity within our nation. In wisdom for all of our leaders, as they contend with the goings-on that have taken place recently, and now we move forward from them. We pray for the leading of the Holy Spirit as we seek a new pastor. We just pray you're watching over the search committee. Just grant them discernment and wisdom as they are seeking on our behalf. Please pray for our elders as they work and pray for us. At this time, we're going to pause for a moment. We pray for Kenny Shea. Please grant him relief from pain. We pray you're watching over Jamie Marble and Joan Troyer for healing and strength, Lord. We think of Nancy Yellen. Please help her physical therapy to be successful and get her arm as back to normal as possible. We pray you're watching over Scott Yelland as his surgery is upcoming. We pray for healing for Carl Hoag and continued healing and a good CAT scan result this week for Terry. We offer up praises for Brian Sawford. Amazing progress. What took place is miraculous, and we know that your touch guided that along the way, Lord. We pray he's able to come home in the next few days, and you'll watch over the transitioning when he gets there. And we pray you'll be guiding Lee as he preaches to us this morning and cause us to take his words and share them with others and to to live by them. In Jesus' name, we offer all this up to you, Lord. Amen. Team, come on up, please.
This next set of songs, I just really felt that the Lord guided me to those. As I spoke earlier, as we lift up his name, the power of who he is, you know, our nation is in a spiritual battle. And like the army of Israel, we are part of God's army. So would you stand with us again and join us as we exalt Jesus today? We're going to praise him and his mighty power with some pretty powerful hymns lifting up who he is. Ephesians 6 tells us that we have the armor of God. We have his salvation, righteousness, truth, faith, his mighty word. So let's go forth as we lift up that praise to him today with "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name." You might feel things are a little shaky, but Christ is that solid rock. Let's proclaim that today. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness fills his loving face, I rest on his unchanging stormy gale. My anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All
the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
And then this last hymn, Mighty Fortress. Powerful song. What a mighty fortress we have in God. Wonderful words, really. Listen to them as you sing.
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, He amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel fate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving Jesus, it is He, Lord Sabaoth His name, from age to age the same, and He must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to of darkness grim, we tremble not for Him. His rage we can endure, for lo, His doom is sure. One little word shall fail Him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The Spirit and the gifts are ours, through Him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also. Truth abideth still, His kingdom is forever.
And would you remain standing as Dan, would you come? But as he comes, let's pray the Lord's Prayer. I mean, how wonderful that those words, the Lord is on our side, we are on His side, His kingdom is forever. And so let's pray that, the Lord's Prayer together, if you would. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, I guess we don't need to look this way. We need to focus right over there. This is called The Singer, and it is Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Wherever Jesus went, lots of people went too. They loved being near him. Old people, young people, all kinds of people came to see Jesus. Sick people, well people, happy people, sad people, and worried people. Lots of them worrying about lots of things. And what I think about when I read that, kids, is like the song we just sang about the world full of devils, but God is on our side. So he's going to teach us about that. What if we don't have enough food or clothes? Or suppose we run out of money? What if there isn't enough and everything goes wrong? And it won't be all right? What then? When Jesus saw all the people, his heart was filled with love for them. They were like a flock of sheep that didn't have a shepherd to take care of them. So Jesus sat them all down and he talked to them. The people sat quietly on the grassy mountainside, and listened. From where they sat, they could see the blue lake glittering below them and the little fishing boats coming in from a night's catch. The spring air was fresh and clear. "See those birds over there," Jesus said. Everyone looked. Little sparrows were pecking at seeds along the stony path. Where do they get their food? Perhaps they have pantries all stocked up, cabinets full of food. Everyone laughed. Who's ever heard of a bird with a bag of groceries? "No," Jesus said, "they don't need to worry about that, because God knows what they need, and he feeds them." "And what about these wildflowers?" Everyone looked. All around them were flowers. Flowers were growing, anemones, daisies, pure light lilies. Where do they get their lovely clothes? Do they make them? Or do they go to work every day so that they can buy them? Do they have closets full of clothes? Everyone laughed again. "Who's ever seen a flower putting on a dress?" "No," Jesus said, "they don't need to worry about that, because God clothes them in royal robes of splendor. Not even a king is that well dressed." They had never actually met a king, but they gazed out over the lake. As they gazed out over the lake, glitteringly and sparkling below them, the hillsides dressed in reds and purples and golds, they felt a great burden lift from their hearts. They could not imagine anything more beautiful. "Little flock," said Jesus, "you are much more important than birds, more important than flowers. The birds and the flowers don't sit and worry about things, and God doesn't want his children to worry either. God loves to look after the birds and the flowers, and he loves to look after you too." Jesus knew that God would always love and watch over the world he had made. Everything in it, birds, flowers, trees, animals, everything, and most of all, his children. And that includes us too, doesn't it? Us adults. Even though people had forgotten, the birds and the flowers hadn't forgotten. They still knew their song. It was the song all of God's creation had sung to him from the very beginning. It was the song people's hearts were made to sing. God made us. He loves us. He is very pleased with us. It was why Jesus had come into the world, to sing to them that wonderful song, to sing it not only with his voice, but with his whole life, so that God's children could remember it and join in and sing it too.
You know, there's no greater power in the world than God's love, right?
And Lee, would you like to come forward now? We're going to sing this little chorus, which we haven't done in a really long time, but I think it'll be familiar to you all, and you can remain seated if you like. But it's, "Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us." And Lee's going to be talking to us about the power of God's love. Well, I don't know what all it will be, but it'll be good because it's about God's love. So let's try this chorus here.
Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. That we should be called the sons of God. That we should be called the sons of God.
Again.
Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. That we should be called the sons of God. That we should be called the sons of God.
Bless you, Lee.
I can't help but notice that each time I speak, there's fewer people here. So I don't know whether maybe you shouldn't put my name on that Friday announcement if I come around again. I'm sort of like an old bloodhound with those saggy ears and that wet nose right to the ground, following that scent that can't be distracted, and as I follow down the Romans 12 road. And I think I'll just stay on that scent until Jubal yanks on my leash into another direction, or he puts me in the pound, one or the other. So I'm here to bark at you and howl at you again on this morning, genuine love. Before I start, I need to recognize Stephen J. Cole's writings as a major direct source of this talk. Last time I spoke was from Romans 12, 4 to 8 about spiritual gifts. Do any of you remember me speaking about spiritual gifts? I see one head nodding. Oop, and one. Yeah, there's another one. I don't know whether they're nodding agreement that they do remember, whether they're nodding off already. So I'd like to go back to Romans 12, 1 and read the whole passage to verse 10, because you can't have Romans 12, 9 and 10 without Romans 12, 1 and 2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body, we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Let us use them, if prophecy in proportion to our faith, if service in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortation, the one who contributes in his generosity, the one who leads with zeal, the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness, let love be genuine.